Well, good evening, and welcome to Tuesday Night Teaching. I'm Minister Deborah Wilson, and I give all honor to God tonight for this opportunity. As many of you know, we held Vacation Bible School a few weeks ago for our youth and children, and this year's theme was Make Waves, and this theme has stuck with me, maybe because I spent so many months with it, but it's something that I also believe is really important to us, particularly those of us who are seasoned with wisdom, that we get this concept into our psychic as well. Now, I know some of you had asked about an adult class during the week of VBS, and of course, we did not have one at the same time that we did one with the children because we really wanted the children to have command of the space and to have the freedom to have fun in their own way while also learning the important principles about who they are in Christ and how God has already equipped them to make a positive difference in this world. So they tossed and punched beach balls and balloons. They made waves to the music and all with the energy and gusto that one would expect young people to bring. And so they weren't stifled too much, just short tearing the building down. And they did have fun. And, you know, in fact, the grown people who were there had fun also, at least I did. But the young people were allowed to play with a purpose. And hopefully they learned a lot about Jesus and about God's love for them. I also hope they learned something that will stick with them for years to come. And as they mature, that they will be able to reach back and be reminded that they are created with a purpose. And because of how they are created and because of who created them, that they can make ways and make a difference in the world around them. Now, I was slated to do this study last week when Pastor Farrow was on vacation, but it just didn't come together technically or practically. So Pastor Farrell has graciously allowed me a second chance to get this right. And so I want to thank him before we go further for that as well. Now, I'm not sure that this study actually makes up for the lack of an adult class, but we're going to use this platform tonight to talk about making waves. And I really want to make this relevant again for those of us who are adults and or maybe seniors, because, you know, when I look over my own life and the lives of people around me that's my age and older, you know, I understand how easy it is for us to start to think that we're too old to make waves or to make a kingdom difference. And if we aren't intentional, we may find that we are just going along to get along. But if, you know, if you really don't get anything else tonight, the big idea here is to encourage you, to encourage me, you know, to make waves because we aren't too old. Now, many of us grew up in church, and it was during a time for me particularly when having a godly purpose wasn't so much of a thing. I mean, the emphasis, at least in the church where I attended, was on doing, well, not sinning. And I just don't recall very much about spiritual gifts and any talk about what God created me specifically to do. And the problem is that if we're still in that mode of Christianity and you're an adult and particularly a senior, you may now just be existing because, you know, we've actually aged out on a whole lot of stuff. You know, there's a song, the things I used to do, I don't do no more. Things I used to say, I don't say no more. You know, the places I used to go, I don't go no more. Well, you know, there was a preacher, I don't know if the story is true or not, but apparently this preacher was at the end of his sermon and in the celebration portion, and he was just giving God glory and praising God in his loud voice and thanking God because the places he used to go, he don't go no more. And the things he used to say, he don't say no more. And the things I used to do, I don't do no more. He said, because I'm not able, right? And I say that to emphasize that, you know, some of the stuff that we no longer do is simply because we're not able. But at the same time, to say it's not so, I want to say it's not so much about what we aren't doing anymore, but more about what we still have the capacity to do. So if nothing else, I mean, we can mentor or provide guidance to some younger person. Listen, there's something, some dream unrealized, something God has gifted you with, or some talent you discovered along the way that can be used to help live on purpose for the upbuilding of God's kingdom here on earth. So there's three things that I want to share tonight. One is I want us to have a good working definition of what it really means to make waves. It's a metaphor so that we're all on the same page that way. Two, I want to remind us again how God has already equipped us to make waves. And then finally, I want to just encourage us to get in the game or stay in the game, because no matter how old we are or how complacent or how stagnant we may have become in this moment, the truth is we are not too old to make waves, and that's important. And I think it's important for all of us as Christians to know that as long as we have breath in our bodies and activity in our limbs, we can still do something to make a difference in this world and in the lives of people around us. But you know, life comes at us hard sometimes, doesn't it? And have you ever found yourself confused by life and wondering whether your days account for anything worthwhile? I mean, I have struggled sometimes through seasons of continual disappointments or doubts, and I have perhaps, and you have even asked yourself as well, is it worth finishing what I've started? Or as Minister Rudy reminded us on this past Sunday, you know, where do we go from here? What direction should I head in now? Well, one of the things we try to instill in our young people during VBS is the same thing that I want to renew in us that gives us meaning in our life. And that is this: God has created us with purpose in our lives. And Psalms 131 verses 13 through 14 shows us God's intent and activity in our very existence. Here's what the word says. For you, and we're talking about God here, created my innermost being. You, God, knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, God, because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works, God, are wonderful. And I know that full well. So I think it would do all of us good every now and again to just pause, even in the midst of times when we have to live with our doubts and fears, but to just pause long enough in those times to remember that God has designed each of us with a purpose, and God has in mind a contribution for each of us to make. But the problem is in actually living out what we profess and what we believe. And as adult believers, it's difficult, even though we have experienced God on some level in our life, and we know with our heads that God is always faithful. We intellectualize that we can trust God no matter what. We even know now that God has given us gifts and talents to enable us to fulfill his amazing purpose for our lives. And he has given us the Holy Spirit to empower us. So why are we here? Why am I here? Well, if you're having difficulty answering that question, then here's one for you to ponder. What do you enjoy doing? I mean, what is the thing or things in which you can lose yourself or lose track of time? And I ask that because your answers will provide clues to what God may be calling you to do. You know, every year almost we hear of some senior citizen who is finally graduating from high school or finally graduating from college. And that always brings me some joy. And I don't know whether you remember this or not, but during the conversation about the Holy Land, Pastor Farrow asked Sister Ty Barnes about going to seminary. He asked her, why now? And, you know, Ty is much younger than me, but her answer was profound. And I share it because it makes a point here. She said, and this is a loose quote here, she says, I believe I had this calling on my life for my entire life, but my other vocations took priority. And she had mentioned that she had been married for 23 years. She's now a widow. She's a mom of three magnificent sons, she said. And so those things took priority, she said. But for the first time in her life, she said she now has the freedom and the focus to actually concentrate on this arm of her vocation, which is furthering her theological education. Now, I know they weren't her exact words, but I do hope I captured the essence of what she conveyed. And I applaud her, and I hope it helps encourage some of the rest of us to take a class, learn something new, learn to use a computer, and learn to use your smartphone, for God's sake. You know, you may be a widow. Your children may be grown and gone. So now you do have time, and you have freedom to explore who God created you to be. Now I think about Moses, and he's mentioned in the book of Acts, the 7th chapter, verse 23. It says Moses was 40 years old when he left Egypt, okay? And then in verse 30, later on, it says that it was 40 years later when the angel spoke to Moses through the burning bush. So Moses would have been about 80 years old when God called him. And I think about Abraham in the Bible, who was 75 years old when God called him to leave this country and set out from Haran at 75. Abraham took his wife, Sarah, his nephew, Lot, all the possessions that they had accumulated and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. So age apparently does not matter to God, and maybe it should not matter to us to be able to give God a yes to fulfilling a kingdom purpose when we receive a call from God at any age. Now, we aren't all going to be like Moses, and we aren't all going to be like Abraham, but I believe that they serve as great examples to encourage us to know that we don't have to remain fearful or complacent, that we don't have to be stuck in the rut that we're in, because when God calls us and we operate in our purpose, God will provide and sustain us, and it will bring much more meaning to our lives. So I'm going to go back to Vacation Bible School. Of course, it was 5 nights, and each night there was a unique theme, and I've kind of organized them in my mind a certain way, and I'm hoping to share the order of things with you tonight, because I think the order works. First, God made us with a purpose. That's some assurance there. The next day, we talked about Jesus inviting people to follow him. And so, of course, you know, God gave us a purpose. He gave us an example. And then he gave us an example of how we can trust Jesus with our life. Jesus will save us if we accept the invitation and come to him and call on him when we're in trouble. And then day 4, you know, the action starts, that we love others the way that Jesus loved us. And then by doing that, by doing all of that, having that assurance, becoming like Jesus, becoming a disciple, then God can help us to change the world around us. And that's the result. Well, let's go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you now for your teaching power. God, we ask that you open our minds and open our hearts so that we may be stirred to hear and to do something that your word has commanded us to do. We thank you, God, for the power of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, for your son, Jesus, who died to set us free. And we thank you, God, that you have equipped and empowered us to make waves in a positive way. And so we thank you now and ask that we will be moved from complacency to action for the purpose of kingdom building. And it's in the precious name of your precious son, we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, so what does it mean to make waves? You might be surprised, as I was, to find that most definitions or synonyms associated with making waves have an undesirable connotation. But that's the first thing we want to talk about. Because after all, if you came up in the same era as I did, you were probably warned against making waves, right? And even in looking at the occurrences of the word in the Bible, when waves are mentioned, it's often not pleasant. You know, there are several mentions of waves in the Old Testament and the New Testament, but here are a couple. Back in the book of Acts, chapter 27, verse 41, the Bible says, "But striking a reef where two seas met, they ran the vessel aground, and the bow stuck fast and remained immovable, but the stern began to be broken up by the force of the waves." Now, the stern of the boat, of course, is located in the back of the boat. The bow is in the front. And among other things, the stern serves to keep the water out of the boat. And we all know what happens when too much water gets into the boat, right? It sinks. And that is certainly undesirable, right? Well, in Luke 21:25, there's a scripture that says there will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth dismay among nations in perplexity or confused at the roaring of the sea and the waves. Again, maybe not so desirable. You see, but waves are those strong opposing forces that crash against the shore, that move anything that's in its way. You know, I've been knocked down by waves before in the ocean. Waves are those forces that crashed against the boat that carried Jonah. They crashed against the boat on more than one occasion of the disciples as they tried to make it to the other side where Jesus was. Those waves, those things that distracted Peter when Jesus bid him to come and walk on water. And we're going to read that scripture a little later. So the connotation of making waves seems to be undesirable, but I want to maintain tonight that the ability and intentionality to make waves can result in a positive outcome. And that's what I want us to really embrace tonight. So here are some other words that I found, some other words or synonyms, if you will, for making waves. One synonym for making waves is to cause trouble. Now, it was John Lewis who said, get in good trouble, you know, necessary trouble, and redeem the soul of America. And this is something he said in 2020, as he stood on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, and commemorated Bloody Sunday of 1965, when he and others made waves and stood up for civil rights. But it was good trouble, right? So it's possible that we can be provoked to make waves and to get into good trouble. But to make waves could also cause a disturbance or to create a stir, to rock the boat, right? So it can also And it can also be to make an impression. Even though these may sound a bit unsavory on the surface, they are really all good definitions. And depending on how you look at them, they can all be positive or produce positive results. So it's important that perspective and intent matters, right? So to make waves, to change the world around us, has to be more than something that just upsets the apple cart. So how do we cause trouble or disturb the status quo or stimulate or excite or inspire or provoke or move or galvanize or encourage, energize, raise, vitalize, revive, or fire up? And one of my favorites is to stir up stuff to make a positive difference in the world around us. Because, you know, that's what Apostle Paul, it's one of my favorites, because it's what the Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy when he was in prison awaiting his own execution. Paul knew he was on his way to eternal life, and yet he took the time to reach back and offer encouragement to a young Timothy to keep the faith. Amen. The scripture says he told him, stir up, make waves with the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. And that gift, that he wanted to encourage the young Timothy with, that gift was to be a witness and to spread the love of Jesus, which is the gospel of Christ. So again, day one, we emphasized that God created people with a purpose. And we went back to the creation story that's found in Genesis chapters 1 and 2. They're very foundational because, remember, I said that we can make ways because we are already equipped. And this is why, because God, the master wave maker, created everything from nothing. The word says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God made waves upon the face of the waters. Now, your Bible likely says, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And that's in chapter 1. But then in chapter 2, when the heavens and the earth were finished and God said it was good, then God took a rest and he formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into him the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And God gave man a purpose. He said, name all the living creatures of the creation, name all the living things of the creation. And then he put man to sleep, updated the model, and created Eve and told them to be fruitful and to multiply. Now, as time went on and man and woman were obedient, were disobedient, but we find that God never left humankind. God never gave up on us. In fact, he sent his son, Jesus, in human form to earth to put us back in right relationship with God. And so our ultimate purpose, I think, interestingly enough, is still to be fruitful and multiply. That is to say, be fruitful as in displaying the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and also to multiply by showing and testifying to the goodness of God and the salvation afforded us through God's Son, Jesus. And it's in this way that I believe we are to be, that we can be fruitful and that we can multiply God's kingdom here on earth. Hey, and listen, if you ever really start to walk in your purpose or to walk in that purpose, it won't take you long to realize that it's bigger than you. And with a purpose that's bigger than you, when it's bigger than me, gosh, we're going to pray to God a lot, and God will help us. And in turn, your life will hold much more meaning. So God created you and God created me with a purpose. And we know that God has given us talents, and talents are those things that God has given us that allows us to excel in certain areas. You know, it may be cooking, it may be photography, it may be speaking, it may be writing, it may be teaching, singing, so many other things. Now, talents, though, represent natural skills that we already may have, or skills that we can develop, okay, with practice. But then there's spiritual gifts, you know, which are given to every believer by God. And they enable us to do those extraordinary or even supernatural things, if you will. And these are the gifts that help us to fulfill the calling that God has placed on our lives. So it may be hospitality, it may be prayer, it may be faith, it may be administration or leadership or discernment or evangelism or even prophecy and more. But each spiritual gift is, again, given by God, and how well we use them and our success is completely dependent upon God and how God chooses to use them through us. Now, I hope you didn't miss that because that's critical. In fact, I'm going to say it again. How well we use our gifts and our success is completely dependent on God and how God chooses to use those gifts through us. So each day, we have a choice to show other people what God is like, and we can show them the difference that God has made in our lives. We can share God's love, we can share God's joy, and we can share God's peace with others. And each of us can do that in our own unique and special way. And it doesn't matter where we are in our spiritual journey, this message is meant to help each of us to see the powerful contribution or provision that God has given to prepare us to make a difference in this world. So listen, the season of life we're in is not the most important thing. The disappointments or the storms we're facing are not the most important thing. It doesn't matter who walked away. It doesn't matter who died. It doesn't matter who betrayed you. It doesn't matter who lied on you or to you. It doesn't matter who divorced you or who quit you. It doesn't matter. We all have a calling to fulfill, and it's bigger than us. You know, and I recently heard T.D. Jakes say during a sermon, he said, it takes more than God's presence. That's P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, which we ask for all the time, right? But rather it takes God's presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E. Amen. So who's ready to make some waves? Y'all go ahead and talk back to me in that chat. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to read a little more lengthy passage of scripture here. And it's going to be kind of foundational for the rest of our lesson tonight. So if you'll turn with me or read on the screen, we're going to look at the 14th chapter of Matthew, verses 22 through 33. Very familiar passage. Anyway, the word reads, immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Now, after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. But shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. And when he saw the disciples, when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." So Peter says, "Lord, if it's you, then tell me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." And that's the invitation that still stands. As Peter got out of the boat, he walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." And immediately, is that word again, immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him and said, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Verse 33 says, then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly you," talking about Jesus here, "are the Son of God." Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Well, let me start with the not so good news first, because here's a truth that's embedded in this passage. Even though God created you, created me with a purpose, brokenness opens the door. Now, there's a quote from Brennan Manning that says, when we accept ownership of our powerlessness and helplessness, when we acknowledge that we are paupers at the door of God's mercy, then God can make something beautiful out of us. Lord, save me. In this passage where Peter briefly walks on water, we find in it that Jesus had just performed an amazing miracle in front of Peter and the other disciples. But you know what? Like Peter, we've all had times when our faith was not big enough and we operated in doubt and fear. But I also find it pretty amazing that even knowing our fears and knowing our faithlessness and our doubts, Jesus still invites us to follow him. And he will immediately reach out his hand and catch us and include us in being a part of what he's doing in the world. And I think that's pretty amazing. Listen, we don't always get it right. And we may even be starting to sink. And that's why it's good to remember that Jesus is always there to immediately help us and to pull us back up. Jesus simply still invites us today to come. Amen. And I thank God. I thank God for that today. Now, I think by now we have realized that God does not always hold back the crashing waves that slam into our lives, but the Bible does tell us that God can use the waves for God's good purpose, and he can calm the waves also. So again, back to our text. And Jesus had just fed over 5,000 people with five loaves and two fish. Again, a miracle in itself. Disciples, again, had already witnessed this amazing miracle. But in just a short time, just a short while, they had seemingly forgotten. They're in a boat without Jesus. Jesus is on the mountainside praying, but he knows his disciples are in trouble. And so the Bible tells us that Jesus comes to their rescue. Jesus was on the mountainside. The disciples were in the water. Jesus was on the mountainside. The disciples were in the water, a long way from land, the Bible says, and the waves were pounding against the boat. Jesus was on the mountainside. The disciples were in the water, a long way from land. And the Bible says the waves were pounding against the boat. And isn't that just like life is for us? Sometimes we are being pounded by the waves of loss. We've been pounded by the waves of death. And we've been pounded by the waves of protest and shootings and killings unnecessarily. And it makes us fearful. We don't see Jesus, but Jesus sees us. And just like in this text, it says, but just before the sun comes up, the disciples see someone or something on the water. They think it's a ghost and they cry out in fear. But Jesus calls out to them to not be afraid. And he calls out to us through God's word and through the Holy Spirit and bids us to come. But in this text, Peter does something that the other disciples do not do. Now, I believe they were all afraid, but Peter was a character, y'all. You know, I've heard some call him the cussing disciple, but Peter was one of the most interesting disciples of Jesus. He was the most outspoken. He was the most assertive, but he was also the most loyal. Now, Peter loved Jesus, and even though Peter denied Jesus, Peter was very inquisitive, and he did not hesitate to ask questions that he did not understand. He always sought clarity, and he would act. Now, Peter was the one who cut off the guard's ear in the Garden of Gethsemane. And so we find that Peter here mentioned, this Peter is mentioned more times in the Bible than any of the other disciples, even the disciple that Jesus loved. And Peter was not a perfect man. He was not a perfect disciple, but Peter was the rock upon which Jesus built the church and upon whom Jesus promised that the gates of hell would not prevail against. So all that to say, it comes as no surprise when Peter in this passage wants to be sure and ask, Lord, if it's you, then prove it. Bid me to come. And Jesus simply said, come. And sure enough, Peter gets out of the boat. He leaves the comfort of the other disciples and he starts to do the impossible. He walks on the water toward Jesus. But it didn't take long because Peter, like us, looked away from Jesus and looked at the wind instead. And he started to sink. But Peter had the presence of mind to cry out, Lord, save me. And the Bible tells us that immediately Jesus grabbed Peter's hand, questioned his faith, but pulled Peter up from the water. And together they climbed into the boat. And the word says the wind died down completely. And the disciples worship him, Jesus, that is, as really being the Son of God. And so all I'm trying to tell us today is that when our eyes are on Jesus, we can do the impossible. When we trust Jesus with our life, we can make positive waves at 50. We can make positive waves at 60. We can make positive waves at 70, 80, 90 years and beyond. We can trust God with our lives, no matter what it looks like. Because if we call on him, he will not let us sink. Now, the main memory verse that our young people learned during Vacation Bible School was John chapter 7, verse 38. And the verse simply says, whosoever believes in me, and there's a clause, as the scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within them. And we know that nothing flows from dead rivers, right? So I'm going to leave that right there and just go on to say this. One of the things that enables us to fully trust in Jesus is because of the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus made for all of us. Now, it wasn't an easy task for Jesus, but Jesus knew it was part of God's plan for him to die for the sins of all people. And if you don't believe anything else about Christianity, you can believe that Jesus lived and that Jesus died. But thanks be unto God, we also believe by faith that the story didn't end there, because in 3 days, we believe by faith that Jesus rose and that he appeared to Mary, that he appeared to the disciples and to others multiple times during the 40 days before he ascended to God the Father. And he showed them during that time that he was alive and that they could trust him. And from their witness, we believe also that we can trust Jesus with our very lives. It means to me, and maybe to most of you, that we can put our faith in Jesus as our Savior. And he now calls us friend forever. And there's nothing in this world that can ever take that away from us. Jesus did make waves, and he did it in the biggest way imaginable, in that he gave up his life on a cross for our sins, for mine and for yours, so that we can be free and live forever for and forever with God. And that alone should be enough for us to want to go make waves and to share his love with others. So now that we are assured that God made us with a purpose and that he sent his son who invites us to follow him and to be like him, we know now that we can trust Jesus with our life. And we get to this one simple idea, this way the rubber meets the road, that we can love others the way that God loves us, or that Jesus loves us. Now, John 13:35 says this: by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples. And the way we show that we are disciples of Christ is if we love one another. And so how can we do that? Well, we can start simply by treating people the way we want to be treated. You know, last January, my husband and I were at Myrtle Beach, and I was praying about some really hard things in my life. And I was walking the beach most of those days at sunrise. And so one morning I saw a lady ahead. I didn't see from which direction she came, but I noticed her. She looked kind of weathered from the sun, and she carried a large stick. It was cool. So she had on a large overcoat, and she had this large stick. I call it a staff because it was oddly shaped and you know, it was worn, I guess, by her use. And I watched her as she walked right up to the edge of the water. She put her hands on the top of that staff, I'll call it. And I said to myself, she's praying also. And I continued to walk toward her as I was headed back to the hotel. And that was the way. Her energy was so strong. But I didn't want to disturb her, even just to speak. But as I got closer, she turned to me and said, I'm praying. And I said, I know, but I didn't want to disturb you. And so she said to me, I felt your spirit coming. And I confessed that I had felt hers. And she thrust her hand out to me and she said, Darlene. Well, it caught me off by surprise. So it took me a second to process that she had told me her name. And so I told her mine. And we exchanged some pleasantries. And then she said to me, you know, I really wish that more people were kind and loving toward one another. And while I agree with her, and I'm thinking in my mind, you know, gosh, you know, that would be a great thing. But, you know, one person can't possibly reach every person. And so before I knew it, I just blurted out. I said, you know, we just have to touch where we go. And she became really animated. In fact, she said, Deborah, oh, my God, write the book. And, you know, I admit I was taken aback, but the experience has been an unforgettable one for me. And I've considered what I should do with that statement. But I share it tonight because we can create a ripple effect if we just touch where we go, just like the ripples come out of the center when we drop a petal into water. It's kind of like what happens when we show God's love to other people. It makes them want to show love too. And that ripple effect can keep going and going and going. So God has been making waves all throughout history. It's historic, and we are part of that. We're part of something that has its roots in 2,000 years of history, and even before that with the followers of Yahweh as the true and living God. And so we are a part of a wave that will never, ever end. You know, the church is bigger than this building. So don't just invite people to come to our church and to worship with us. No, invite people to be part of kingdom building. And don't you just come to church, but live a life that creates a wave that makes our homes better, that makes our neighborhoods better, that makes our cities better, our schools and our workplaces better. Make waves that make this world a different and a better place, because what God is up to is just that good. Amen. Amen. Touch where you go. Hey, it's my prayer for us in our lives together here at Reader, that we would create kingdom waves that would impact people to follow after God. You know, from the beginning, God created everything in this world, including you and including me. And our world, God's creation, shows us how magnificent God is. I mean, look at the mountains, look at the oceans, look at the clouds, for God's sake. And on top of that, we are created in the very image of God. So let's show the world who God is by showing God's goodness and love in our own unique way, with our God-given skills, with our personalities, with our age, and with our gifts. Don't give up and don't give in. You know, it's not always easy, but here's the best part. We don't have to do it on our own. You know, God sent us a helper in the form of the Holy Spirit who dwells in us and who helps us to grow in our relationship with Jesus. And as we put our faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit will work in our lives to produce things like joy, like peace, like love, like patience, like kindness, and all those other fruits of the Spirit. And they are not just for our own good pleasure. It's how we are to make ways. It's how we are to use our gifts and talents to show others the difference that God has made in our lives. And as we do that, we work together to make the world better for the people around us. We'll have to pray. We'll have to be strong. We have to be courageous, because kingdom building will take strength and complete dependence upon God. So go ahead, make ways, or keep making ways, as the case may be. And if you're not sure tonight about how, then I encourage you to, one, read your Bible, two, pray for God's direction, and then follow the will of God. You know, things and worldly possessions are only camouflage, but we spend a lot of our time and money on status things. But the real promise is not the things, and it's not the things, it's not the presence, it's not the P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, it's the presence. And we have started to think more, I think, about the presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S. And the generations behind us are starting to think more about the presence, the P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S. But we need to help our children and our young people understand that God created us with a purpose. He gave his son, Jesus, to restore us into right relationship and to show us how to live on this earth. And this is not about property, not about things. This is about God's presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E. The real gift is God's promise that I will not forsake you and I will not leave you. Not that we won't have to cry, or that we won't have struggles, or that we won't have to fight, but the promise is that I will be with you through the tears, through the struggles. God will be with us in the fight. And when we show enough live on purpose for God, the battle will not be ours. It will belong to God. So let us offer real worship to God who created us with purpose. Let's follow Jesus and learn to be real disciples of Christ. Let's trust Jesus with our very lives and practice real ministry and service. Let's share God's goodness with others through fellowship and love and with our actions and not just our mouths. Amen. Let's be on mission. Amen. Amen. Well, I do hope that you've been blessed in some way by this sharing tonight, and that you are ready to make ways in whatever way God is calling you. And I hope that you will not let age be an excuse or a barrier. Trust God with your life and the time that he has given you. And as always, we ask that you support the ministry with your giving. You know, God loves a cheerful giver, and it's because of your generosity that ministry still happens here at Reader. And the giving options are on the screen for you, and for real, any way you bless us, we will be satisfied. God bless you until we meet.